somebody should with his driveway.
Okay,
with his
oh, yeah. And I mean, fight you tooth and nail about it.
Mr. Seaman could have got a driveway.
There's a woman like that.
Well, I call to order the regular scheduled council meeting for Monday, August 26, 2013. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Madam Clerk, roll call, please.
Santos.
Present.
Battle.
Present.
Vasquez.
Present.
Cuevas.
Present.
Orange.
Present.
Maldonado.
Present.
Arnold.
Present.
Parks. Franciscan.
Present. I have a motion to accept the minutes for the regular scheduled meeting for Monday, August 12, 2013.
So moved, Mr. President.
Second.
Motion was made by Councilman Santos, seconded by Councilman Battle. Any questions on the motion? Madam Clerk, roll call.
Santos.
Yes.
Battle.
Yes.
Vasquez.
Yes.
Cuevas.
Yes.
Orange.
Yes.
Maldonado.
Abstain.
Arnold.
Yes.
Franciscan.
Yes. Do we have any communications from the mayor?
No.
Any communications from department heads?
Yes, payroll warrant 081613.
So moved. Second.
The motion was made by Councilman Cuevas, seconded by Councilman Santos, to accept payroll warrant 081613. Any questions on the motion? Madam Clerk, roll call, please.
Santos.
Yes.
Battle.
Yes.
Vasquez.
Yes.
Cuevas.
Yes.
Orange.
Yes.
Maldonado.
Yes.
Arnold.
Yes.
Franciscan.
Yes.
Accounts payable warrant report 080913CC.
So moved, Mr. President.
Second.
Motion was made by Councilwoman Vasquez, and seconded by Councilman Battle, to accept accounts payable warrant report 080913CC. Any questions on the motion? Madam Clerk, roll call.
Santos.
Yes.
Battle.
Yes.
Vasquez.
Yes.
Cuevas.
Yes.
Orange.
Yes.
Maldonado.
Yes.
Arnold.
Yes.
Franciscan.
Yes.
Accounts payable warrant report 082613CC.
So moved.
Second.
Motion was made by Councilman Cuevas and seconded by Councilwoman Orange to accept accounts payable warrant report 082613CC. Have any questions on the motion? Madam Clerk, roll call, please.
Santos.
Yes.
Battle.
Yes.
Vasquez.
Yes.
Cuevas.
Yes.
Orange.
Yes.
Maldonado.
Yes.
Arnold.
Yes.
Franciscan.
Yes. Any committee reports? Any board reports?
Yeah. Henry Rodriguez, council's appointed to the Waterway Management District. Not much except to say that the dredging is completed for the season. They're going to try to start up again the spring, probably April or something like that of next year. And contractors, like they've done in the past, are going to probably hold a public meeting, and they've had it here in the council chamber a couple of times to let the people know, the public, whoever attends, what they're doing and how much further they're probably going to go. The parkway I mentioned to you, the Army Corps of Engineers has agreed to go ahead and finance that, and board received a letter from the mayor where he had inquired about the parkway, and in part I will tell you what part of what Mr. Trevino sent back to the mayor saying that the, at a meeting held on July 30th, 2013, between ECWD and the Corps, they agreed to beautify the parkway from Clyden Avenue to the canal in which the Corps will remove and dispose of existing gravel and trash along the parkway. They will place weed preventive fabric. They will also place landscaping rock and manage weed control along the fence in the parkway. So that's what the Army Corps of Engineers had decided, and to save costs too, they're going to use their own people to do that. Okay, so we have nothing happening over there as far as dredging. We have other things, but that will be discussed later. Any questions?
Councilwoman Orange?
No new fencing. Did they ever discuss about putting in the fence?
Well, with them, yeah, the fabric. They talk about, you talk about that green, oh, you talk, okay.
I'm talking about the fencing, like, you know how BP has that?
Right. That there, well, you know what, it was kind of a tug of war to get this parkway thing done. And the reason, I guess one of the reasons they decided to was we let them take down the green fabric along the fence line. And as far as something other than we'd like to see up there, that's probably going to be down the road a little bit. Okay, it's just not, Army Corps of Engineers, like a lot of government bodies, are going to plead poverty. So, you know, it might be forthcoming, but right now, you know, parkway's getting done, that whole strip of the way. So that's something that's going to be, it's on our radar for the future.
Thank you.
Councilman Santos?
So is the fence going to stay up? They're not pulling the fence down, are they?
No, the fence, that green fabric that you put up, that's coming down. The fence is staying.
So you'll be able to see through the fence now, but the fence will be up?
Right, yeah. Fence is going to stay. No, it's got to stay.
Any other questions for Mr. Rodriguez? Thank you. Madam Clerk, do we have any ordinances on first reading?
Yes, 13-0023, sponsor Mayor Anthony Copeland, transfer of appropriations.
So moved on first and second reading.
Second.
Motion was made by Councilwoman Orange, seconded by Councilwoman Vasquez, to hear ordinance 13-0023 on second reading. Do we have any discussion on the motion? Councilwoman Orange?
I think, is this the one that, from the public?
It's appropriation.
Public Works?
Yes. Ms. Corsby, please. Your name and title for the record.
Monty Corsby, Public Works Department.
The workers, we kind of talked about this a little bit in our workshop, but as far as the workers, these are going to be part-time workers?
Yes.
And how long will they? I think it's only, what, 150,000, so mm-hmm. It's not going to be long.
I believe the way the numbers were calculated, that's going to take us until at least the end of the year to get the 25 at part-time, 25 hours a week that they're going to get. I'm not sure. They were talking first it would be $8, and then they went to $10, so we're right now in the middle of that. I just left with Sandra, and they're still discussing the rates, but I believe the 150 that they're anticipating to transfer over, it's for 25.
And this was advertised so that maybe the people that got laid off could come back and apply for these jobs?
Yeah, and that's what we're hoping. We're hoping that the people that got laid off, you know, are given the opportunity to come back. The jobs are really hard to find, and we're finding that a lot of them that were laid off, they still haven't found a job. But I was able to review some of the resumes and letters that were submitted, and we probably have out of there maybe five of them that I saw that were actually laid off. There was a big batch. I wasn't able to go through all of it.
And so what would they be doing?
They will be helping the department, and, you know, I know that the Public Works Department was, as you know, they were, was created, and we took on a lot of responsibilities. And just so that the council is aware of just of some of the items that the department itself actually is taking care of, I wanted to make note. We do the garbage collection, the recycling collection, the yard waste. We cut the high weed and vegetations for abandoned buildings and homes for through code enforcement when they send over our work orders. We do graffiti removal. We do sign removal and replacement. We're in charge of cutting the parks and maintaining the parks, keeping them clean. We do the maintenance on all of the municipal buildings. We do the street paving. We do the street sweeping. We do the downtown cleanup. We, when the snow starts, we're going to be in charge of the snow removal. We do the rubbish cleanup. So within our department, you know, although they view it as, you know, we were combined, even with the combined effort, we a lot of other responsibilities have come about. Now, when we had the ability to have the summer program, we were able to use the summer workers to clean up the weeds that grow on the base of the curbs. We were able to start painting the curbs. We were able to do a lot with that extra force that we had. So what we're looking to do is with the part-timers that we're going to be getting, hopefully, that we're going to be able to get, we want to continue with that. We want the city to stay moving forward with where we're at. You know, we get a lot of requests from the residents, from elderly people, we even from the council precinct committee people, and we try to attack them as fast as we can. With the workforce that we have and with the responsibilities that we've taken over with, the force that we have now, we can do just that. When we want to try to do the additional, it's very hard, and it takes a minute for us to get to. Councilman Santos, we were able to address that issue at the park, and it took me a week to do. But if I, you know, with the added help that I get in your district, in Battles District, we've been able to get the high weeds that are going on. We have a lot of special events that are happening, and when we had the extra crew, we were able to tackle that quicker, because now we also, once the parks have events, we're responsible for making sure that we put up the tents, that we set them up, that we take the picnic tables, that we take the tables, whatever it is that they're requesting. So with this added group, this, I believe that it will help the department and the city move forward in not only cleaning but providing better services.
Will you be doing anything with the alleys?
That's we're going to focus on opening up the alleys. Councilwoman Vasquez, just as a request that you had when we had the summer workers, she gave us an alley that she was having a big problem with. And if you look at that alley now, there's a big difference. And we want to target opening them up. Even though it's the homeowner's responsibility, we all know that sometimes, you know, because maybe they're working too hard or just for whatever the case may be, you know, out of sight, out of mind, they don't really look in their alleys. But because we are out there and we see them, yeah, we look to address them, to open them up, to clean them, get rid of those weeds, to rake out all of the debris that are coming up on the fence line.
Just one other thing, Mr. President. I'm hoping that when you do the alleys, that a letter is going out to the people, like say if you target an area like in the 4th District, that a letter goes with that to let people know that that is their responsibility. These weeds are not trees, and they're not, you know, that's what they're supposed to be doing. Because once you clean it up, you know, they should be responsible for keeping it clean. Maybe it's an elderly person or that can't get out there, and that's a different situation. But for the people that can, that's part of you having home ownership. And if it's not for the owners, it should be the landlord. Maybe can pay somebody to do that. So once it is clean, and I'm hoping that if you do an area, a letter accompanying it to come around and say, hey, we're doing it, we're getting it all clean for you, but the next time, code enforcement, because it's got to be a stop.
Yeah, we would do that. And I know that another concern with the councils as well was with the street sweeping. We were able to trained some street sweepers, and with this group, we also want to start posting as we did in the past. We hadn't done that in a while. We sometimes when we get the calls, where we identify the streets that need to be posted so we can street sweep them all the way to the curb. But that's another thing that we wanted to use them with. But I will make sure that we advise the homeowners and the areas that we're going to be in to before we clean.
And also the foundations of East Chicago has an opening period. I seen that on the billboards. Maybe you could write to them and add another 150,000 maybe to continue to work so that we can continue to help clean up the city.
Okay.
And put people back to work that way.
I will.
Councilman Santos.
Monty, how many employees are you, or how many employees is this going to get you?
I guess the target is 25.
25?
Yes.
And how many months is that? How many months worth of work before you're...
The way I see this, 25? I believe this is a... I want to say it's probably, looking the way they have it, probably between 4 and 5 months. But that doesn't say that that's locked in. If it's a program that's going to work, I'm sure we can continue, you know. And I welcome everybody to follow the program. And if it's a good thing, we need to keep it rolling.
And... You're anticipating, if the council passes this tonight, you're anticipating to have these employees by when?
Well, they're submitting their resumes in now.
Yeah.
So hopefully by next week, start interviewing them. So within 2 weeks, there's a screening involved, but I don't know how long that is. I would love to have them start next week, but I would have to get with Sandra.
And the reason why I asked Monty is because I'm just trying to figure this out as far as when is it your busiest month? Is it like... You know, is it now or is it like in the beginning of the summer? Just so that if we do continue this and as we move next year, hopefully we can get it down to where you really need those guys.
It's easier if I tell you what's our slow months, not the heavy months.
Okay.
The slow months are January and February.
Okay, so anything else?
Every other month is heavy.
Councilwoman Vasquez?
Yeah. Well, not just because you're standing here, Monty, but thank you very much for always answering your emails, always returning calls, and for being there. Because when I told you I had a crucial area, I am the precinct committee person that tried before with the residents, but sometimes it just doesn't work out. I told you that I had to get it done this summer, and you took care of it in 3 days. So thank you to you and your staff for working so, you know, so hard. And that alley looks great.
Yeah, it does. No, and I'll make sure that I let the staff know, because all I do is just... I ask them to do it. It's the employees. I give my 100% to the employees. I wouldn't be able to do it if it wasn't for them, each and every one of them, from the janitor to the driver to the labor, every single one of them, they're the ones who make the department.
Right, and you make the department, Monty, you know. But anyway, just, you know, thank you for getting that alley cleaned up, because it had been an eyesore for probably 3 years. The other questions I had, Adrian asked them, so thank
okay.
you.
And
Councilman Sons.
I just want to likewise say, like Councilman Vasquez, Monty, you know me, we've dealt, and I call you, you are always on the spot, and it does start up top, Monty. You are an excellent department head. Whenever we call, I know you're out there, and I see you've got 20 people calling you, and you start calling people, but Monty, no, it does start up top. And you know what you always done, every time I've called, you are right there. So, no, I
thank you.
Echo the sentiments of
thank
Councilman
you.
Vasquez.
Any other questions? Madam Clerk, roll call to adopt Ordinance 13-0023.
Santos.
Second reading.
Santos.
Yes.
Battle.
Yes.
Vasquez.
Yes.
Cuevas.
Yes.
Orange.
Yes.
Maldonado.
Yes.
Arnold.
Yes.
Franciski.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Next ordinance, please.
13-0024. Sponsor, Councilman Judah Parks. An ordinance to amend Title 11 by adding Chapter 131 to the East Chicago City Code to deal with garage sales within the city.
So moved. No
seconds.
A motion was made by Councilwoman Orange, seconded by Councilman Cuevas, to hear Ordinance 13-0024 on second reading. Do we have any discussion on the motion? Councilwoman Orange?
Mr. Bauer, maybe you can answer, since Councilman Parks is not here. I wasn't at the committee meeting, but a couple of things I had wanted to ask, and I know we have one more reading with this. They talked about these group and districts and blocks, but every year United Neighborhood Inc. has a citywide garage sale, and I don't see that this applies to them for $25. I think they have maybe 100, maybe 120 people. I don't know how that would work when you have a sort of like outside person coming in to do this. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, and that was not addressed. Most of the dialogue during the committee meetings were talking about a block sale. In other words, 6, 8, 10, 12 residents on a particular block. The large one that you're talking about was not discussed during the committee meeting.
Okay. Council.
Just one other thing, too. When they're talking about posting the signs up on utility poles and stuff like that, is there going to be a fine for them posting? They say the city will come back and the city will remove all illegal signs, but if they're putting them up there, those people should be contacted. And they should be taking them down, to take a city worker to take down signs for garage sales.
If they illegally post a sign, then you've got an ordinance violation and you've got the code. The concept during the committee meeting as to how this was to be handled is that all of this information would be provided to the person when they came into the controller's office and paid their $5 or their $25, whatever it was, as to what they could do and what they could not do. It is always a tendency for people to go down to the corner of their block and to start tacking up signs on light poles or what have you. That's the concept. Judah Parks mentioned that when one of the times that Kim Anderson was here, that all of this would be part of the permit application, so that when they paid their $5 and they signed the thing and they get a receipt, the do's and don'ts are listed.
Okay, thank you.
Councilwoman Arnold.
Attorney Bauer, I thought that we did discuss large group sales, and that they had said that they would just
exempt.
Yeah.
I thought so too.
Yeah. Well, they're going to come in, they're going to pay $25, and you've got the huge group. Once again, part of the application is they got to identify when, where, you know, how many people, you know what they're doing. There was no extensive discussion of what to do about the large ones. And the whole concept of festivals was not addressed by this. The committee pretty much focused, I'm just looking at the individual garage sales or the smaller neighborhood garage sales.
Councilwoman Maldonado.
Mr. Bauer, on that note, I was under the assumption that the word community in that section D specifically spoke to the large garage sale that is being discussed right now with Neighborhoods Incorporated, in addition to district and block garage sales. So I thought that it was discussed. That's what I'm trying to say. So is a $25, for example, when Neighborhoods Inc. puts their garage sale, citywide garage sale together, that would be community. So it's either it is or isn't, because the word community then is misleading. So I'm just trying to figure out.
I think Benita is the one that came up with the phraseology of the community, district, or block garage sales. And if I recall correctly, the intent was really to be across the board.
To include then?
That's the neighborhoods. We limit them to two for the community or block sales.
Yes.
That was the reasoning behind that.
That's the reason why you've got the limits that are in there.
Again, but my question is, does the community one include the neighborhoods incorporated one? That's what I'm trying to figure out.
I think the committee's understanding was that it did.
It did, okay.
Councilwoman Arnold?
Yeah, Attorney Bauer and my council members, I believe it did because this came up right after the community-wide garage sale, and we had said it was such a success, we didn't want to kill it with, you know, with some large fees. Okay. We were limiting that particular community organization to twice a year doing these events and just taking away some of the hassle of them having to have each participant come into their office and give the $5. So this was just something that we were doing as a city to promote the garage sales, I think I'm correct.
Councilwoman Maldonado?
So then the large garage sales were discussed?
Yes.
Okay, because there was some confusion there. Okay, fine.
Any other discussion on the motion? Madam Clerk, roll call to adopt ordinance 13-0024 on second reading.
Santos?
Yes.
Battle?
Yes.
Vasquez?
Yes.
Cuevas?
Yes.
Orange?
Yes.
Maldonado?
Yes.
Arnold?
Yes.
Franciski?
Yes. Madam Clerk, do we have any ordinances on second reading?
No.
Any ordinance on third reading?
Yes. 13-0021, sponsored by Anthony Copeland, and ordinance amending ordinance 0-010016 concerning real estate in the city of East Chicago, which is used or permitted to be used by the owner for illegal activities and declaring same as public nuisance.
So moved on third and final reading.
Second.
A motion was made by Councilwoman Vasquez, seconded by Councilman Cuevas, to accept ordinance 13-0021 on third and final reading. Any questions on the motion? Madam Clerk, roll call, please.
Santos?
Yes.
Battle?
Yes.
Vasquez?
Yes.
Cuevas?
Yes.
Orange?
Yes.
Maldonado?
Yes.
Arnold?
Yes.
Franciski?
Yes. Do we have any resolutions?
Yes, 13-0016, sponsor Councilman Adrian Santos, resolution of the Common Council of the City of East Chicago, honoring Reverend George C. Murray, son.
So moved, Mr. President.
Second.
Motion was made by Councilman Santos, seconded by Councilman Cuevas. Any discussion on the resolution?
President.
Councilman Santos.
Can we have Madam Clerk read it in its entirety, please?
Resolution of the Common Council of the City of East Chicago honoring Reverend George C. Murison. Whereas Reverend George C. Murison was born February 18, 1916 and passed away March 22, 1996. And whereas Reverend George C. Murison was born in East Chicago to Train and Nina Murison, Father George was a lifelong resident of East Chicago, graduating from McKinley Elementary School and Roosevelt High School. He was magna cum laude, graduated at St. Joseph College in Rensselaer in 1936, where he was also the editor-in-chief of the 1936 St. Joseph College Yearbook. In addition, he was also a member of many other clubs during his college years. And whereas Reverend Murison later graduated from St. Menard Seminary in Southern Indiana and was ordained into the priesthood on September the 13th, 1942 by the Most Reverend Basil Tekek of Moohall, Pennsylvania. He became the pastor of St. Nicholas Romanian Church Catholic Church in East Chicago, corner of Alcott and 143rd on May 3rd, 1943, where he served until 1994. Concurrently, he also served as pastor of St. Demetrius Church in East Chicago from 1947 through 1957 at the intersection of 138th and Butternut. Whereas in 1987, Father George was appointed Vicar General of the Romanian Catholic Diocese of St. George the Martyr, a member of the Romanian American Youth Society. He served as editor and administrator of the Urena Almanac over 18 years and was instrumental in the original idea and development of the American Romanian Catholic Association, as well as the conference center and camp in Walcott, Indiana. And whereas Father George was past president and chaplain of Knights of Columbus, Mensar Connolly Council 1700 in East Chicago, past president and life member of East Chicago Noon Lions Club, and recipient of the Melvin Jones Fellowship Award, highest recognition in Lionism, and member of the Calumet Stamp Club. When he passed on March 22, 1996, he was buried from St. Nicholas Romanian Benzat Catholic Church, where he served for over 50 years. Burial services were on Wednesday, March 27, 1996. It is therefore resolved by the Common Council of the City of East Chicago that in honor of the Very Reverend George C. Murison's contributions to the spiritual life of so many residents of the City of East Chicago, it is warranted for the City of East Chicago to recognize his efforts and dedication to the people of East Chicago by dedicating the corner of Alcott and 143rd in his honor. The corner of Alcott and 143rd shall be named and known as the Reverend George C. Morrison Drive. Be it therefore resolved that the city install the appropriate sign, street signs, to reflect this solution.
Any other discussion? Madam Clerk, roll call, please.
Santos?
Yes.
Battle?
Yes.
Vasquez?
Yes.
Cuevas?
Yes.
Orange?
Yes.
Maldonado?
Yes.
Arnold?
Yes.
Franciski?
Yes. Resolution passes. Madam Clerk, next resolution, please.
Resolution 130017, sponsor Councilman Judah Parks. Resolution establishing a procedure for towing fees within the City of East Chicago.
So moved.
Second.
A motion was made by Councilman Cuevas, seconded by Councilman Battle. Do we have any questions on the motion? Councilwoman Orange.
Ms. Bauer.
Attorney Stephen Bauer, and I'm eager for Judah Parks to return from his vacation so we can answer all his committee.
I know that it says that it reflects and the towing costs of surrounding areas, but was this the in the committee, was it the cost of what they're charging in East Chicago for towing costs? I know it was sort of kind of, it said something about it reflected the cost of, they looked around Lake County, and this is some of the northern Lake County or some of the neighboring costs of the, that's how they did the comparables. But what I'm saying is the East Chicago towing companies, is this their cost?
I'm not sure. I know Whiting, Hammond, and Gary all have a similar type of ordinance that establishes what they're going to pay when there is a police-ordered towing.
And that's the only one that they're governing. It's not like if I call for a tow myself, it's not going to govern me. They could charge me whatever they want.
That's right. Okay. You can pay whatever you want.
I just wanted to make sure that was.
We cannot regulate the amount of private contracts.
Right. Okay, I was trying to make sure.
Councilwoman Arnold.
Attorney Bauer, you know, I had a concern with that scene cleanup, the fee, the yeah. range, and I thought he was going to work on that because it didn't change.
Right. Well, it's a minimum of 30 and a max of 60.
Yes, but I told him personally, I thought maybe we should have a set fee, because how do you regulate what's small and what's large?
I think during the committee meeting, Judah indicated usually it's the officer on the scene that monitors.
I didn't get that understanding. They told, from what I was told, they couldn't take pictures or anything. So since we really have no way of recording, you know, if it took you 10 minutes or 1 hour to clean it up, that we had a standard fee. If it took you 10 minutes today, then you got your set fee. If it took you 1 hour tomorrow, you still got it. So it kind of evens out in the long run and keeps everything on a steady pace, because I would hate for the resident to have to pay this fee, correct? The resident, the person whose car is towed, I'm just assuming they're an East Chicago resident.
Yes.
They would pay this fee, correct?
Well, it's going to be any tow. It may not necessarily be an East Chicago resident.
I do understand that. Right. I'm just, but
it's more
my focus is East Chicagoans. So my point is, most of us in this community are already in poverty levels. So if we could probably keep it where, you know, it's a mishap with the towing, if we can have a standard fee so they don't feel like they have been, you know, charged just because the color of the skin, or if the man was tired because he had to get out of bed at 2 o'clock in the morning, so I'm gonna tack this extra fee on you. So I'm just asking, this did stay the same, right? He did not take that into consideration.
It was not changed. The only thing that was changed after the meeting was the addition of a fee for flatbed tows.
So as the council attorney, am I to ask him to reevaluate this fee or give me a reason why he did not? Because it's coming with no explanation.
Well, sure you can.
Okay.
Table. I mean, you can ask for it to be you can ask for it to be tabled and reconsidered at the next meeting, and ask Judah's committee to reexamine it.
And it's simply based off the fact that I just, you know, I know people have a hard time, and we don't need to stick.
You had mentioned that before, mm-hmm. but apparently Judah Parks did not feel that it was needed to be changed. He may have reasons for that.
Councilman Cuevas?
Yeah, you know what, Steve? We did discuss these certain fees, and that was one of them that we touched on. We thought it was a little pricey, and it was supposed to reduce it or modify it. The same thing with the disposal fee. Most tow trucks, like before, whether it's an accident or whatever, police called or not, they normally just clean up without a fee. They always usually just pick it up, get the debris out. It's part of their tow, what they charge the general public for any crash or any towing like that. So we were debating that too at that meeting, and we were trying to see if we can get that down, and it didn't change. It stayed at 20. We're trying to maybe get it to $10 or something like that. So yeah, you know, we it didn't change. None of the prices really changed on that at all.
Councilwoman Vasquez.
And if I remember correctly, Councilwoman Arnold, I think we did lower it to $30. We had said we were going to have a flat fee. So, I mean, if it's, you know, if we don't want to amend it on the floor, then maybe we should make a motion to table it for now.
Considering
that Judah, the sponsor of this resolution, is not here, I would like to take into consideration his judgment, the reason why he did not. Maybe he knows something I don't, being in enforcement.
Motion to table. Councilwoman Orange.
I'll make a motion to table.
Yeah, second.
Resolution 130017 until we can get clarity from Councilman Parks on his intention.
The motion was made by Councilwoman Orange, seconded by Councilman Cuevas, the table resolution 13-0017. Roll call, please.
Santos?
Yes.
Battle?
Yes.
Vasquez?
Yes.
Cuevas?
Yes.
Orange?
Yes.
Maldonado?
Yes.
Arnold?
Yes.
Franciscus?
Yes. Resolution tabled. Next resolution, Madam Clerk.
13-0018, sponsor Councilwoman Benita White Arnold. The East Chicago Common Council resolution supporting the Northwest Indiana Federation of Interfaith Organization Job Coalition.
So moved.
Second.
Motion was made by Councilman Cuevas and seconded by Councilwoman Vasquez. Any questions on the motion? Councilwoman Arnold?
It's not a question. I was going to ask if I could have the two members of the Federation come forward and give a brief explanation. For my council members, if they didn't read it in depth, the print was kind of small.
In brief, please.
Thank you, Mr. President, and to the council. This ordinance, the purpose of this ordinance really is...
Resolution.
This resolution really is to get at the matter of job creation here in Northwest Indiana. The Regional Development Authority, this body gives $3.5 million to the RDA every year for the past 10 years, I think. That's a lot of money. And what we see is that we're not getting our jobs. We're not getting a return on the money. And there's all kinds of excuses being made on why residents from East Chicago, residents from the worst, the most unemployed zip codes in our region are not getting any of these jobs. If you drive around, and I drive around quite a bit, and go to the projects, we had one African-American in Gary work on that project. There's many, the city just is going to receive $38 million. And what we want to do is guarantee that we get the citizens, the most unemployed people get an opportunity to get these jobs. There are provisions in this agreement that we have for training. We're talking about putting aside money for training. That's been one of the excuses. We are working with different entities who have trained people already. We have had people train, over 100 people trained from the Brownfield project that are ready to go to these jobs. And we just believe without the pressure from the city council, from the legislative bodies that put this money up, that we believe that we will not get our fair share of jobs. And we believe that, it's the RDA regional. Why shouldn't a person that live in East Chicago get a job in Valparaiso? You know, not just jobs here, but Valparaiso, there's projects from this RDA in Valparaiso, Whiting. So why shouldn't a person who's unemployed have an opportunity? So that's what this resolution is about. We believe we have all the components in there to train people where it's a seamless transition. You get trained and you go get a card. You get trained, you go to work. You get on the job training and get a card. So we believe all of that. And this, it's been modeled all over. St. Louis project, the Alameda, California project. There's only been one project, to my knowledge, in the history where 50% of the residents of East Chicago worked on a Central High project. For 2 years, we fought to make that happen. And it happened because we worked in close association with the Human Rights Department, who monitored the contractors. Because when they say they can't find somebody, well, we say, we'll help you, we'll sign people up, but they're out there. They're out there.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions? Councilwoman Orange?
So this is just not involving the airport, the Chicago airport.
This is the Regional Development Authority. This is we put in 3.5, Hammond 3.5, Gary 3.5, the county 3.5, Porter County, right? They put in 3.5 million. So this is not just about us, you know. This is about the whole region.
Don't go anywhere.
Okay. So since 2011, how successful have you been?
We haven't been successful because there's no stick with the carrot. We need a stick because they don't want to upset the traditional cart, but the traditional cart is not getting people here in East Chicago jobs. It's not getting people in Gary jobs. We need something that's going to push the RDA. They keep saying they want to do this. Okay, we're saying councils, the people that put the money in, help us by putting the stick with the carrot.
Any other questions?
Can I please
state your name, please?
To this great council. 97% of the jobs that have gone to the airport, the man hours worked, have gone to people who do not live here. The 3.5 million that you put in is leveraged by Peter Biskowski. And that 3.2 turns into millions. How many, at least $30 million have already gone to the airport through the monies that, it's your money that they're spending. And they have the arrogance to say to all of the cities that we do not have to honor your agreements.
Right.
They've said that all Gary Hammond, East Chicago, they said we will not honor your agreements. When the contractors go to contractor business, they are told to ignore that section in the book that deals with regional agreements. They disrespect you. Gary has already agreed with us, and they have their resolution. We've gone to them, and we need a groundswell. The communities must go together in order to get their attention. It's your money. The citizens of East Chicago, Gary Hammond, and the most disparaged areas are being completely left out. And you have the power to make a great difference through this resolution. That's all I needed to say. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And I apologize that I didn't give my name, Emmett Mosley, 4217 Barron Avenue.
Thank you.
Reverend Asher Harris, Pastor Great Band, Mr. Kennedy.
Thank you. Thank Madam Clerk, roll call, please.
Santos?
Yes.
Battle?
Yes.
Vasquez?
Yes.
Cuevas?
Yes.
Orange?
Yes.
Maldonado?
Yes.
Arnold?
Yes.
Franciski?
Yes. Resolution passes.
That's it.
Madam Clerk, do we have any old business?
Tax abatements.
Mr. President.
Councilwoman Maldonado.
I make a motion to accept the CF1 for the following East Chicago businesses: Centier Bank, Lakeshore Coal, Fritz Enterprises, and Middle Steel. These are existing tax abatements that are on their tail end and they will soon expire. They were discussed in the workshop that the council had on Wednesday. And this is just a formality, just to keep these going until they expire.
Do we need a motion on that? Do I have a second?
Second.
Motion was made by Councilwoman Maldonado, seconded by Councilman Cuevas, for tax abatements on the following. Any questions? Councilman Santos?
Unfortunately, I wasn't able to make the workshop because of my employment. But is there any information that was given out as far as how much money and what are the years and employees and all that other good stuff?
Mr. Bauer, could you step to the podium?
What were the stipulations that with these companies? Were they, you know, when we give out tax abatements back then, we put some stipulations on some of these companies, and they needed to hire so many, you know, East Chicago residents, or are they meeting those standards? I'm not sure.
At the committee meeting, Attorney Steve Bauer, at the committee meeting, the mayor's office and I think economic development presented information on almost all of these. A couple of them were in their last year and had made compliances for a number of years. They were all felt to be qualified and in compliance with what the original agreement was. Now, sometimes in the original agreement, they just talk about the quantity of the actual cash investment. Other times they talk about number of employees. Those reports were in fact filed and the committee looked at them. The one that is not resolved today was the big new one with BP Amoco. And consultant Jim Bennett reported that the construction had not been done and that this wasn't up and off the ground yet. Carl, were you present during that?
I was not.
Okay. So the end result is that the only one you're not looking at right now is the BP Amoco. The others appear to be, from the information that we received at committee meeting, were in good shape.
Was there, and Mr. President, mm-hmm. I'm just asking that as we move forward and we start dealing with some of these, because I'm sure there's probably going to be some more, that maybe they can put in our packets, you know, some of the information. Because I looked at it before, but I didn't see nothing, and I was kind of just surprised. And one more question. Do you think the city of Chicago is going to go into litigation with BP Amoco? Because they came up here and they asked us, and they smiled and said, oh, we're going to do so great. And I've gotten wind about a little bit of what's going on, and what I'm hearing I'm not too happy with. And BP Amoco is making millions.
Billions.
Billions, yeah. Millions by the hour, billions by the day.
Yes. Yes and no. There's much more to be done on that. And James Bennett, on behalf of the mayor's office and economic development, indicated that there would be much more that needs to be done on the huge $4.5 billion tax abatement petition that was pending.
And Councilman Santos?
One more quick statement, Mr. President. If you could, as the president of the city council, either ask the attorney, the city attorney, that they involve our attorney, Mr. Bauer, in some of these discussions, because the city council was the one that actually passed this abatement. Yeah. So I think that it'd be wise that we have you there so that you can be giving us, nobody's gonna give us an update other than you and tell us what's really going on over there. And I, for me, for a fact, I don't want to listen to nobody else other than you, because we pay you to give us advice on what's going on. And I think that this BP Amoco thing is gonna get real ugly. And we're gonna need our city attorney fighting, because they came up here and they smiled. Oh, they smiled from, you know, from ear to ear, how great it was going to bring this community. Now, from what I'm hearing, is that, you know, there's going to be litigation. So I want you there.
Okay.
Councilwoman Maldonado.
Councilman Santos, we will have several committee meetings in reference to the BP Amoco issue. That's why it's not on the agenda, because that's, we're not moving forward on anything like that. And to speak about these tax abatements, these are the tax abatements that this council has been approving. These are about 7 years old, if I'm not mistaken, Mr. Bauer. So for the last 7 years, this council and the council prior to this council, I had been approving these. So this is just a formality to these. And again, they will expire soon. No new tax abatements at all are we discussing tonight.
Councilwoman Orange.
That's definitely correct.
Councilwoman Orange.
And make sure you have Carl Sender there too, because we want the money people figuring out what's going on too. The law side is fine, but the money people, we want them there. And also, Councilman Santos, we want to make sure the BP Amoco doesn't do a sleight of hand and go through the urban enterprise, for which they can do, and go through the state. So since you are on that committee, along with Kim Edwards, we want you guys to be vigilant.
I'll be smiling ear to ear.
don't try to make sure they don't go through that.
I'll be smiling ear to ear waiting for them.
Yeah.
Madam Clerk, roll call, please.
Santos.
Yes.
Battle.
Yes.
Vasquez.
Yes.
Cuevas.
Yes.
Orange.
Yes.
Maldonado.
Yes.
Arnold.
Yes.
Franciski.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Councilwoman Orange.
This is also in old business. In our meeting that we had on Wednesday, Kim, the city controller, came up and she told us, and we're still kind of dealing with this merit board situation, from what she told us, that the State Board of Accounts did not accept how we had put the payment for the merit board. So we have to have a separate paper, not what we had before as a resolution. Has to have a separate paper, and so I'm going to make a motion that this be put into our minutes. And she said that they could use that part of it. So I'll just make the motion as Mr. Bauer had asked me, that had told us how it had to go. I move for our minutes to show that the $50,000 we appropriated in 2013 for the police merit board was intended to pay all of the police merit board expenses, including meeting and attendance fees. And that was for the 2012 year, because that was never settled. She said I don't know how that got passed, but since State Board of Accounts is here, this is what they asked her for, and so I'm asking that be placed into the minutes as a motion.
Second.
Motion was made by Councilwoman Orange and seconded by Councilman Cuevas to put in
that statement.
The statement for the record for the State Board of Accounts for the Merit Board. Do you have any questions? Roll call.
Santos.
Yes.
Battle.
Yes.
Vasquez.
Yes.
Cuevas.
Yes.
Orange.
Yes.
Maldonado.
Yes.
Arnold.
Yes.
Franciski.
Yes. Do we have any new business? Councilman Santos.
Madam Clerk, if you can send a letter to the engineering department on the alley of 145th and Bering, going west to Geneva Court. The alley, at the tail end of that alley, it's really, really bad. It looks like it was buckling up, and there's a lot of potholes. And also, in regards to Geneva Court, when they redid that area, they paved it, and they used one layer of paving. And when they did the curves, there's about, I would say, 3 to 4 inches left that needs to be paved, because the curves, the actual street doesn't meet up with the top of the curb. So it seems like when they did that redevelopment in that area, contractors just said they either stopped or, so I'm not sure what the contractors are doing with the engineering department, but the residents over there had the expectation that that was going to get done, because now you have sewer caps, and I'm sure that it's probably difficult for Monty's crew when they go out there and they plow. The sewer caps are like, maybe, you know, they're about 7 inches off the ground. So when they come through there and they plow, I mean, that's got to be tearing up our city plows. So I would imagine that needs to be paved. Those 7 inches of pavement, it needs to be put in there. And I don't know that that's at the cost of the city. It should be cost of the contractors that build that little cul-de-sac and had it named after his daughter, I remember, when he came here. So if you can send a letter to them and to the engineer and ask him in regards to what's going to happen there.
Any other new business? Councilwoman Orange?
If, Madam Clerk, if you could send a letter to Diane Kraft from the We Care of the Heart. She did a day of caring along with the United Way, City of East Chicago Park Department, and the also Monsey's Department and Mayor Copeland. They came and they cleaned up the Pennsylvania Center. They painted, they cleaned up, they took the tape off the windows, and it was a good day to see people coming together to help the center. I hate that it wasn't more community people in that center that day, because after all, they used the center. But she did put it together. It was very nice, and it spent about 10 hours just doing nothing but cleaning and painting. So if you could send a letter to that group, and if there's anybody else on that list, Vivian, I'll get it to you. Also, if you could send another letter to the Minister Alliance. I know we're supposed to have a meeting with the foundations of East Chicago to figure out what is really happening with the money that's supposed to be used for the residents of East Chicago. We had a meeting. It was canceled. We have not heard when that second meeting is supposed to, the new meeting date is supposed to take place. I would like to know when that date is, and so that the members of the council that want to attend can be there.
Any other new business? Councilwoman Arnold?
I'll give the clerk a chance to catch up.
Madam Clerk, if you could send a letter to the Director Maria for the Department of Redevelopment and to the Redevelopment Board President. It has come to my attention that a young man in the Calumet area is trying to purchase some property at 501 East 149th Place, better known as the Big Dipper. And I am so proud of him because he submitted a proposal with his business outline. He wants to provide basic necessities with a convenience store, frozen food, snack bar foods like popcorn and hot dogs. He's gonna have healthy food in there. He put in his hours of operation that would be vital for the council to approve, 6 a.m. to 10 p.m. Monday through Saturday. He's not even considering selling alcoholic beverages or cigarettes. And he's gonna staff it with a person of at least 21 years of old or older. And his response has not come back to him in writing, even though he sent them this response on October the 1st, 2012. He has not gotten a response in writing as to why he cannot purchase that property. He's gotten it verbally, stating that the board thinks that it would be a nuisance to the area. And I kind of don't agree with that. I don't think they should have the end all to his future, because he's a lifelong resident of East Chicago. I'd like for them to give us some answers as to why this business should not even be considered by this young man. He's doing what we want all East Chicagoans to do, open up a business and stay in East Chicago. So I want them to come before the council. Don't send a letter now. Come before us with an explanation as to why this young man cannot be considered or have the opportunity to purchase this business. Because East Chicago and the Calumet area is a food desert. Young kids are walking from the projects all across Kennedy Avenue to go and purchase candy and eggs for their families. And that's, you know, we have a young man willing, and I want to help him help our community. Thank you.
This time we're moving on to public expression. If you could please keep your comments to 3 minutes. First, we have Mr. Mayfield.
My name is Harkeem Mayfield. I live at 4700 Locksboro, Apartment E. Trying to take an eyesore out of the community. It's a store that's sitting on the corner. It's been sitting there vacant for almost 5 years. And I'm just trying to give back to the community. I have a dream to try to help my community, where these kids wouldn't have to walk to the gas station, across the busy intersection of Kennedy Avenue, to get basic necessities like bread, juice, milk, little things like that. I'm just trying to do something right and give back to the community. I've been here all my life, and I just want a chance to be able to help my community. Instead of taking my business elsewhere, I want to do it in my community. That's all I have.
Thank you.
For having me. All right.
Next we have Mrs. Mary Ann. I know you don't want me to get that last name, right?
Mary Ann Peeble Varnick, 532 Riga Place.
I would have guessed right, too. I should have said it. But.
Good evening, President Franciscan and council members. I would like to personally thank First District Councilman Adrian Santos for sponsoring the resolution naming the corner of 143rd and Alcott the honorary Reverend George C. Murison Drive. Affectionately known as Father George by generations of Romanian Byzantine Catholics who he baptized, married, and buried, along with others of different ethnic backgrounds here in East Chicago and across the country. He had other talents, which included being a great violinist and a musical composer. He was one of the very few pastors who was born, raised, and served the citizens of East Chicago his entire life, not only as a priest and pastor, but as being involved in many civic activities and organizations. Thank you for keeping his memory alive with this honorary naming of the street, which coincides with the 100th anniversary of St. Nicholas Romanian Byzantine Church at that corner, which was established in the late winter of 1913. Once again, thank you. Thank you, Adrian.
Thank you. This time we do not have any more slips. I entertain a motion to adjourn.
So move.
Second.
Motion was made by Councilman Battle, seconded by Councilman Santos. Madam Clerk, roll call, please.
Santos?
Yes.
Battle?
Yes.
Vasquez?
Yes.
Cuevas?
Yes.
Orange? Maldonado?
Yes.
Arnold? Franciski?
Yes. Meeting adjourned. Good night.